Dr. Karan Singh, the Deputy Director General, Mr. Getachew Engita, Dr. Scilla Elworthy, Mr. Ananth Duriyappa, ladies and gentlemen. Nonviolence is the greatest force at the disposal of mankind. It is mightier than the mightiest weapon of destruction devised by the ingenuity of man. On 2 October 2016, on the birth anniversary of the father of our nation, India portrayed this might in a manner true to the Mahatma's principles. We ratified the Paris Climate Change Agreement, cementing proof of India's, as the Mahatma would say, indomitable will to fight the violence being perpetrated against the environment. The idea that peace must extend to not just humankind, but our environment as well. This was our tribute to a firm believer of sustainable development who has shaped the narrative of peace for all. UNESCO, with its efforts to utilize education, science, and culture to mitigate violence against the voiceless, the underrepresented, and the oppressed, couldn't be a more appropriate forum for today's event. The Ahinsa talks, underpinned by the values of peace and nonviolence, are especially crucial in today's turbulent world. The question is, how do we get there? What are the tools? Who can do it? The distinguished Dr. Scilla Elworthy will speak to all of this. I will also say that we at the Mission of India have been particularly pleased to collaborate with the Mahatma Gandhi Institute, of which Dr. Karan Singh is the chair for this special event. The New Delhi-based Category 1 UNESCO Institute, which proudly bears the name of the Mahatma, is clearly on its way. My good wishes to them as they move onwards and forwards in what must now be a common endeavor to forge peace towards a more sustainable world for all. I have now the honor to offer the podium to the Deputy Director General, Mr. Getachew Engita. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Dr. Karan Singh, Chairman, Governing Body, UNESCO Mahatma Gandhi Institute for Education for Peace and Sustainable Development, Excellency Madam Ruchira Kamboj, Ambassador, Permanent Delegate of India to UNESCO, Dr. Ananth Duriyappa, Director, UNESCO Mahatma Gandhi Institute for Education and Sustainable Development, and Dr. Scilla Elworthy, three-time Nobel Peace Prize nominee and recipient of the Niwano Peace Prize, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. I'm deeply honored to speak at the inaugural Ahinsa lecture series to commemorate the International Day of Nonviolence. I wish to commend the permanent delegation of India to UNESCO and our Mahatma Gandhi Institute for Education for Peace and Sustainable Development for this initiative and for inviting such a prominent champion of peace to deliver this lecture. We're delighted to have you here alongside Dr. Karan Singh, whose wisdom, intellect, and spirituality have guided our organization over the years. This lecture goes to the heart of UNESCO's DNA, ladies and gentlemen, to build the defenses of peace in the minds of men and women. The International Day of Nonviolence marks the anniversary of the birth of Mahatma Gandhi, who once said that, I quote, "I have nothing new to teach the world. Truth and nonviolence are as old as hills," end quote. He has taught the world and changed the course of history. From his experience to defending rights in South Africa, to uniting India in a national independence movement, to inspiring movements for freedom and civil rights across the globe. At the height of the freedom struggle in India, he is known to have famously remarked, and I quote, "An eye for eye only ends up making the whole world blind, unquote. One of the most influential peacemakers of our times, Mahatma Gandhi's approach to peacemaking continues to find relevance in today's turbulent times. He advocated the creation of pluralistic structures. He proved that despite the several apparent differences, communities can unite for the promise of a shared, peaceful future. Above all, he promoted the idea of ahimsa, or nonviolence, as a goal and means to create a peaceful future. In Mahatma Gandhi's words, peace is its own reward. We need the vision and value of giants like Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and Nelson Mandela to navigate our turbulent times. On the one hand, globalization is creating limitless opportunities for collaboration, dialogue, exchange, and growth. It is also, on the other hand, generating divisions caused by enduring poverty and growing inequality. Our societies are increasingly fragmented, tearing at the fabric of humanity. We're witnessing an unbridled growth in violent extremism. Terror is striking at the heart of societies, from Paris to Brussels to Tunis to Istanbul, Indonesia, and elsewhere. Humanity's cultural heritage and diversity are under attack. World heritage sites are destroyed to eradicate the message of tolerance and dialogue that they embody. Minorities are threatened. Climate change poses a steep challenge. And the world is facing the most important refugee and displacement crisis in our time. An estimated 1.5 billion people today live in regions affected by conflict. 40% of them are young people. 28 million young girls and boys are out of school. 73 million young people are unemployed. Now more than ever before, freedom is under threat, ladies and gentlemen. Freedom of speech, freedom of movement, freedom of choice. I'm reminded of Nelson Mandela's words. To be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others, unquote. We need to break down walls where they exist, not build more between us. An honest and transparent dialogue that goes beyond tolerance, that leads to acceptance, inclusion, and mutual respect is the need of the hour. This idea lies at the core of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development adopted by world leaders last year. Sustainable Development Goal 4, which aims to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, has as its target 4.7, the promotion of a culture of peace and nonviolence, global citizenship, and appreciation of cultural diversity of culture's contribution to sustainable development. In this regard, I would like to say a few words about the vital role played by the UNESCO Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Education for Peace and Sustainable Development. This unique institute, established with the generous support of the Government of India, located in New Delhi, is UNESCO's first Category 1 institute in the Asia-Pacific region and works exclusively on the targets specified in SDG 4.7. In this short span of time since activities began in 2012, the institute has proven to be ahead of the curve. Through its youth networks and emphasis on developing innovative ICT-based pedagogies, as well as initiatives in rethinking curricula, the institute has positioned itself as a leading institute for transformative learning for peace and sustainable development. Last month, at the UNESCO's International Conference on the Prevention of Violent Extremism through Education in New Delhi, the institute hosted its flagship Talking Across Generations on Education. This unique plenary saw youth delegates and policymakers from across the world engage in an honest and open dialogue on the prevention of violent extremism. The rich discussion was widely followed on social media. The session trended on Twitter, earning over 25 million unique impressions. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, as we look towards the principles of nonviolence for guidance, I'm sure there are valuable lessons and solutions to be found for sustainable peace. In this spirit, I welcome and look forward to your lecture, Dr. Elworthy. You have now the floor. Thank you very much.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be invited by the Mahatma Gandhi Institute for Education for Peace and Sustainable Development and by the Indian delegation, because these issues are so close to my heart and have been for so long. And I know that this distinguished lecture series is intended to initiate an international discourse to build this more peaceful and sustainable world. And that the current Ahinsa talks commemorating Mahatma Gandhi's birth anniversary, also observed as the International Day of Nonviolence, aim to emphasize the relevance of Gandhi's principles, because not only his work on nonviolence, but his example to the world of how to make nonviolence robust is an example to us all. I'm also inspired by Indian Prime Minister Modi's recent words at the World Sufi Forum. He said, "Let us challenge the forces of violence with the kindness of our love and universal human values. And lastly, let us restore the light of hope and turn this world into a garden." Then we're back again. It's very exciting to hear a national leader using the word love, and it's very important. Now, the work I do has involved me over the years with people who seem to have a lot of power. Physicists who design nuclear warheads, military officers in charge of nuclear weapons, manufacturers who produce and sell missiles and machine guns, strategists who design defense policies, as well as those who sign the checks, not just in America, Russia, France, China, and Britain, but also India, Pakistan, and Israel, as well as those who have the unenviable task of having a finger on the trigger. I've spent years listening and opening dialogue with these individuals. And I also now work for the last 16 years with people who risk their lives to stop other people being killed by these weapons and trying their best to build peaceful societies. That means I meet and get to know people like Gululai Ismail in northwestern Pakistan, who convinces young jihadis not to become suicide bombers, meaning that her life is in danger every day. I also have got to know an ex-child soldier in the Congo who swaps goats for children kidnapped by militias and brings them home. And then the hard work of reintegrating those child soldiers begins. I have watched how a network of rural women in Zimbabwe have stopped electoral violence. And I had the great privilege of observing at first hand the peacemaking skills of Desmond Tutu Mary Robinson and Nelson Mandela, and Grasse Machel in the development of the elders. That, as you may remember, was an idea developed by Peter Gabriel, the singer, because he realized that the world is now a global village and needs global elders. Now, at this point in history, I conclude that humanity, as we've just heard, has built up looming threats to our security. But those threats now are threats that weaponry cannot even begin to deal with. Global warming, the rich-poor divide, migration, overpopulation, and terrorism. Thus, it's time to take a very hard look at both the military-industrial complex that drives war and others for whom war means wealth. By that I mean those who take advantage of the chaos of war to traffic people, drugs, money, and guns. It's time to divert the skills of the military-industrial complex and our skills to making what humanity now needs, to access a better kind of intelligence, to demonstrate how conflicts can be prevented and resolved without armed violence, and to make peace profitable. That's why I want to talk to you about why war continues, how peace can be built, what it will cost, and who can do it. What I've seen of war and the building of peace convinces me that human beings are well able now to find better ways to resolve conflict than by killing each other. What I'd like to talk to you about is a first attempt to answer some of the tough questions involved. It's by no means finished, and your improvements and ideas in questions will be very welcome. So I want to introduce this subject by telling you a very short and very remarkable story. It's about Lieutenant Colonel Chris Hughes, who was leading his patrol down the streets of Najaf in 2003 in Iraq. Those were the days when you could still lead a foot patrol down a street. And suddenly, people came swarming out of the houses on either side of the street, screaming and yelling and obviously furiously angry about something that had happened. Now, the platoon that Chris Hughes was leading was very young American soldiers, didn't speak any Arabic, and had no idea what was going on. In a second, Chris Hughes pointed his weapon at the ground, strode into the middle of the throng, and gave his soldiers an order they had never heard: kneel. And they were very shocked. So they wobbled to the ground in their heavy body armor with their enormous weapons and pointed them into the sand. And complete silence fell. And the silence remained for 2 or 3 minutes, and then everybody went home. And the reason I tell this story is because it demonstrates two things, two very powerful principles of nonviolence. And the first is that the greatest driver of conflict is humiliation, and the best antidote to humiliation is respect. And what that young lieutenant colonel knew how to do in that moment was to show respect, and thus averted a bloodbath. And the second principle is that of presence. He was so awake in that split second that he knew what to do. And those are the qualities that we have to develop and are developing in young peace builders. Now, what we're developing is destined for the millions of people who are now so horrified by what they've seen of war since the turn of this century that they want to act, they want to do something to stop this tsunami of suffering. They're asking, at every event that I speak at, every conference, every broadcast, every online course that I teach, what can I do? This is an upsurge of passionate commitment noticed by all my colleagues, and it's coming from the ground up. Yet people feel helpless against the enormity of war. Syrian cities entirely reduced to rubble. Terrified people fleeing barrel bombs and chlorine attacks. Endless columns of massive tanks pounding their way into new territory. Unidentifiable fighter planes screaming overhead. Little girls of 10 auctioned to warlords who rape them so viciously that they die. What we hope to begin in this current work and for others to improve is to offer ways in which this upsurge of popular will to end war can find traction. And to do this, it's vital to understand the forces that drive war and why wars continue. And here I should say that it's important to make a distinction between war and conflict. Conflict is neither good nor bad. It's simply energy, and as such, is a part of human experience. War is also a part of human experience, but the assertion of our work is that war is no longer necessary. We now know enough to make wiser decisions and to implement them and to save the trillions of dollars that can be used now to alleviate suffering, educate, feed, and bring water to tens of millions of people, and help the world, the earth, to regenerate. So first, why is it in our interests to stop war? Most of you in this room will be familiar with these reasons, so I'll be brief. Violence costs vast amounts, while the building of peace is extremely cost-effective, but totally underfunded. The 2016 Global Peace Index report found that the economic impact of violence to the global economy was $13.6 trillion in 2015, equivalent to $5 per day for every person on the planet. A quick examination of the numbers reveals that the world continues to spend vastly disproportionate resources on creating and containing violence compared to what it spends on peace. In 2015 alone, UN peacekeeping expenditures of $8.27 billion totaled only 1.1% of the estimated $742 billion of economic losses from armed conflict. So the money saved from war can save people. Food, clean water, safety, and refuge can be offered. World Beyond War calculate that it would cost about $30 billion only per year to end starvation and hunger around the world, and about $11 billion per year to provide the world with clean water. What if another $450 billion went into providing the world with green energy and infrastructure, topsoil preservation, environmental protection, schools for everyone, medicine, programs of cultural exchange, and the study of peace and of nonviolent action, of which this program that we're celebrating here with its Changemaker program is an excellent example. Second reason is that militarism can't address the threats that we're now facing. As I said, climate change, migration, water shortage, and particularly the rich-poor gap. I'll come to that, but first, a couple of shock facts on water shortage. 1 billion people worldwide have no access to clean water, whereas it takes 15,000 liters of water to produce 1 kilo of beef. And dealing with the marginalization of the majority of the world's population, the Oxfam 2016 report shows that the wealth of the poorest half of the world's population has fallen by $1 trillion since 2010, a drop of 38%, whereas the wealth of the richest 62 people has increased by more than $500 billion to $1.76 trillion. So global inequality is growing so fast that it will fuel further terror groups and revolutionary movements. Is war necessary anymore? So we're all aware that this past century has seen some of the most terrifying and destructive wars in human history, but it has also, for the first time in human history, seen the greatest achievements in cooperation. Witness the European Union, witness the United Nations, as well as the greatest advances in expertise on the prevention and resolution of conflict. The knowledge now available in multiple locations includes the Peacemaking and Conflict Prevention Program of UNITAR, the Network of Field Operations and the Conflict Prevention Center at the OSCE, and the Women in Security, Conflict Management and Peace, a pioneering peace-building initiative in New Delhi, and many others. And about 400 colleges and universities around the world now offer peace studies programs and training courses, and notable research units, like the famous Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, offer multiple databases that we can draw on monthly. So, coming to why war continues, we have to address the fact that the global arms trade fuels war. It remains secret and unregulated. And here I have to nail the fact that the five of the world's largest arms sellers are the five permanent members of the UN Security Council. And this is known in my country as a seat at the table, a seat desperately prized by the United Kingdom as a badge of still being a great power. It also clarifies why the arms trade, why efforts to curb the arms trade have so far failed. Over a decade, Western defense and security policies have been predicated on heavy military spending, the failure to abolish nuclear weapons, pragmatic alliances with despotic governments, the arms trade and arms racing, multiple coercive interventions in other countries, and torture. Even presuming benign intentions, the securitized enforcement of the prevailing order has ruptured millions of lives, plundered resources, and crippled local and national economies in the process. And this way of thinking relies on a hardware approach. We compete to have the most advanced technological weapons, and we send out spies to discover enemy inventions, and we build security domes in the sky. Nevertheless, we human beings are capable, quite capable, of adopting instead a software approach, even at the very top. Software means dealing with people, developing trust, finding common ground, and it's what the best of tough leaders do. It's what Mandela did when he came out of prison in opening dialogue with the white government of South Africa. I'll just tell you a quick story about Mandela and his energy. I think it was the third time that I met him. And he started to speak to a group of about 60 people. And he's got a raspy voice, and he isn't an orator. He doesn't do oratorical flourishes. But I got goosebumps when he started to speak. 35 minutes later, I still had goosebumps. And I asked myself, why is that? And eventually I realized what it was. It was the energy of this man's integrity, pure energy. Somebody you absolutely could not cajole, persuade, or push over. A tower of strength. So, I want to move on now to how war can be stopped. And I want to talk, I think for the first time ever, of a business plan for peace. To date, as far as we know, no one has produced such a plan. Based on systems that we know effectively prevent conflict and build peace at different levels, local, national, and international. And the plan I'm going to tell you about is based on different assumptions from those used to underpin current decisions. And they enable people to envisage a different kind of future. The first assumption concerns the power and the cost effectiveness of the prevention of armed conflict. And the second concerns the profitability of peace from a business point of view. So prevention is the overall strategy. A coordinated strategy for the worldwide transformation of conflict will have to concentrate on prevention for obvious reasons. As we've seen, war costs a fortune. While preventing war and building peace is extremely cost-effective, yet totally underfunded. When I last did the sums, I worked out that for every $1,885 spent on promoting and waging war, $1,885 is spent on the prevention of armed conflict. So, to prevent armed conflict avoids all the long-term fallout of war. Centuries of revenge, terrorism, floods of refugees, children maimed for life, and families destroyed. And this joined-up strategy is necessary because we look at those who take the big political decisions on war and we see the gulf that separates them from the civilians who have to face the consequences. And the overall strategy is to develop a whole systems approach to the building of peace worldwide from, as I said, the local level to national, regional, and global levels. So, if I first deal with systems that effectively prevent conflict and build peace at the local level. First of all, I'm looking at the support of locally led civilian initiatives. Now, you might not think this amounts to much. And indeed, I wanted to know the answer to that question in 1999. So I initiated a research program to look at everything that was known about local people working to prevent and resolve conflict in their own communities. And we identified 350 viable initiatives and wrote up 50 of them in a book called War Prevention Works, which was very widely circulated and published in 2001. Now, when we did similar research 6 months ago, Peace Direct, the organization that developed out of this research, found that there are now four times as many identifiable, reliable, effective, and measurable locally led peace initiatives in hot conflict countries worldwide. So there are now 1,200 peace-building organizations across 31 different conflict-affected regions. And one of these is led by Gululai Ismail in northwestern Pakistan. And what she does is she's trained 220 young men and young women to go into the madrasas, identify young men who are being trained to be suicide bombers, and go home with them to their families to discuss why the Quran would not approve of that kind of jihad. And she has so far prevented 220 intended suicide bombings. Secondly, breaking the cycle of violence. As we know, Atrocities start a cycle of violence. They cause terror and trauma, followed by grief and then by anger. And if nothing is done at this point in the cycle of violence, anger leads to the drive for retaliation. Retaliation brings revenge, causing an escalation of atrocities. And this cycle of violence is perpetuated over generations and even centuries. The cycle can be broken by providing physical, political, and psychological security through tried and tested methods of conflict prevention. These include training women, I'll come back to that, consultation with religious leaders, bridge building, all these things which are not very glamorous and don't hit the headlines, but they are the building blocks of the prevention of conflict. Setting up truth and reconciliation mechanisms, training mediators, freeing child soldiers, trauma counseling for those who have been so deeply injured by war. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, for example, my friend Henri Bourreladi, who was himself a child soldier, now devotes himself, whenever Peace Direct can send him a small amount of money, like $100, he gets on his motorbike and he rides into the bush and he buys a herd of goats. And he then drives the goats to where the militia are hiding, which in itself takes his life into his hands, because the militias, as you can imagine, are trigger happy, they don't like strangers, and they're high on drugs. But he knows how to talk to them, and he negotiates one goat, price $5 for one child, and takes the children home. And then the hard work of reintegration begins. Now, moving on to systems for preventing conflict at national and regional levels. How many people, I wonder, in this audience have heard of infrastructures for peace? That is what Nelson Mandela set up when he came out of jail in 1989. He realized that the period during which the negotiations were going on for independence in South Africa, for a multiracial government, would take a long time. In fact, they took 4.5 years. And he realized that that time was ripe for civil war. And I lived in South Africa for 10 years, and I know what he said was true. And what he did was to set up a national peace council, regional peace councils, city, town, and even village peace councils, onto which were elected people that the communities could trust. That means women's leaders, religious leaders, sports personalities, and youth leaders. And the job of these people on all these levels of councils is to develop a peace plan for their area, be it a village area or be it the whole nation. And that peace plan must be ready to be in operation at the first sign of the eruption of violence. So that is what stopped the necklacing, you know, the putting a car tire around somebody's neck and lighting it, that was happening in some of the townships from escalating into full-scale war. And it was incredibly successful. That has now been copied by Kenya, has passed legislation for an infrastructure for peace, and so has Ghana. And the amazing thing is that to set up such an infrastructure in a country costs only $2.5 million. To get the people trained, to get the system set up, to get the peace plans going. And then it costs about $500,000 to maintain it year by year. So when you consider what the incredible costs are once war breaks out, this is nothing as a preventive measure. This is what we're talking about by the viability of a costed peace plan. So what we want to see happen is that 10 governments, those in perhaps of countries that are most liable to internecine violence, should set up an infrastructure for peace, and that's what we've costed. Now, the UN itself created a peace-building commission in 2006 to marshal resources and advise and propose strategies for post-conflict peace building and recovery. They don't concentrate so much on prevention. The United Nations Peace Building Fund is a multi-year standing trust fund, again for post-conflict peace building, established in 2006. And it's got an initial funding target of 250 million. It's not very much. The UN could invite all member countries to appoint a senior level executive, an Undersecretary of State for peacebuilding, for example, in the United States, and equivalent posts in other countries, to design conflict prevention policies and ensure the necessary resources and coordination with foreign and defense ministries. Why haven't we done that? It's so obvious. I want to now come to women. Now, as you probably know, women are known to be and shown to be the most effective and tenacious peace builders. And yet, still, 90% of negotiators and those in policy-making positions on peace and conflict are male. Meaning that the suffering and trauma, and this is important, it means that the suffering and trauma of the majority of the victims of war are not taken into account at the peace table. Again, if I've got time, a quick story. Usha Haji Elmi was known as the Lioness of Somalia, and she'd been working on women's issues in Somalia for many years. And when it came to 1999, and the peace negotiations, there were five clans sending delegations to the peace table. And none of them had a woman on their delegation. And Usha went along to them and said, "Can you include some of our members on your delegation?" And they said, "Go away." So she formed the sixth clan, composed entirely of women. And that sixth clan got a seat at the table, with the result that negotiations produced an agreement for 12% of the seats in the new parliament to be allocated strictly for women. There are now four women ministers in Somalia. So it's extraordinary what women can do when you give them the chance. Another proposal of ours is to set up regional rapid response funds. Now, this is necessary because when conflict builds in an area, you need a response fund that can go into action immediately. It's what we have in hot conflict design, but we don't have it yet for peace. I want to talk quickly about peace buildings. Now, we talk a lot about people who are peace builders, but they've got no home. In none of the hot conflict countries is there a building dedicated to peace builders where they can meet, strategize, have conferences, do training, build capacity, and so on. So one of our aims in this costed peace plan is to engage one of the top architects in the world to build a peace building in every one of the 10 worst conflict-affected countries. So going on to international level, obviously, a global break on arms trading. In my own country, the subsidies and the export credit guarantees that are given to the arms trade, if that were given to the production of socially useful goods, it has been shown in research that we could create twice as many jobs. So the fiction that defense manufacture is a sacred cow because it provides so many jobs is simply not true. So young people are now galvanizing to organize a global campaign to impose a global 20% tax on arms trading. So I could go on if I had time to talk to you about the enterprises that thrive on peace. But I just want to give you one role model from high finance. After successfully building two international software companies, Steve Kililea, an Australian, decided to dedicate most of his time and his fortune to developing a peace institute. He founded the Institute for Economics and Peace, and now every year they publish the Global Peace Index. And that indicates all the countries in the world from the top to the bottom in their capacity for a peaceful society. I can just remember a few at the top, but Iceland normally makes it to the top one. New Zealand's normally somewhere near the top. This Global Peace Index now gets more coverage globally, worldwide, than any other peace statistics. And of course, there is the United Nations Emergency Peace Service that I could talk a little bit more about. But I'm not going into the detail of our costing now, but I just want to let you know what is the provisional total figure we have come to. And again, it's a work in progress. And that is to develop a 10-year program for the prevention of armed conflict worldwide would cost $1.7 trillion. And when you consider that the effect of armed violence on the global GDP annually costs $13.6 trillion, you can put it in context. And just in conclusion, I'll mention a short word about who can do this. So we've actually listened and talked to people at all sorts of levels about what they're able to do and what they would like to do and what their ambitions are to do. Because what I'm having constantly in my inbox is literally hundreds of announcements of new organizations started mainly by young people, some of them internet organizations, where young people, particularly the millennials, are getting together to organize themselves to build peace. So, obviously, you can get behind the kind of locally led peace initiatives that I'm talking about through Peace Direct. But also, we're encouraging people to boycott the kind of celebrity rich lists that are all over celebrity news and replace them with lists of local heroes, the people who risk their lives so other people don't get killed. And then we're suggesting that in your school or your community or your workplace, just make known the shock statistics that face us now. I'll give you one or two. In the United States in 2015, more people were shot and killed by toddlers than by terrorists. A recent Harvard study found that 51% of young adults do not support capitalism. By 2050, there will be more pieces of plastic than fish in the world. Nearly half of humanity do not yet have internet access. And between 1992 and 2011, less than 10% of those at the negotiating table and only 4% of those who signed peace agreements were women, as I've said. So those kind of statistics are very important that people know them. And then locally, in your own family or community, break the cycles of violence that you know about by using dialogue and non-violent communication, NVC. Google it. It's the most wonderful system for stopping. I've stopped conflicts in my own family that have been going on for 20 years by using this methodology of non-violent communication. And then if you want to move on to national levels, campaign for your government to build a national infrastructure for peace. Organize massive global online support for politicians who take a stand. There are wonderful people like the Swedish Foreign Minister, Margot Wallström, who took a stand against Swedish arms exports to Saudi Arabia, which are going to Yemen to cause mayhem. And she actually took a stand on that, and she received the most terrible abuse for it, but she stuck to her guns, so to speak. Point out to editors of your national media how frequently they carry stories about war and terror compared to how rarely, how very rarely, they feature the brilliant stories of peace builders, some of which I've told you tonight. And celebrate those who prevent armed conflict. Make them heroes. Send them messages of support. Just look on the website of Peace Direct, very simple website, and you'll see all over it the stories of people who are doing this. And they love to receive messages of support. And if you just send them to the address at Peace Direct, they will pass them on. And there are so many people, including the White Helmets in Syria, who go in when the barrel bombs fall and rescue people from the rubble. And they've saved more than 62,000 lives, and 121 of them have died doing it. And these are ordinary civilians like you and me. So many more that I'd like to mention, but just a couple to finish with. Contact and support indigenous groups and learn from their wisdom. We know from the people we work with in Maori communities, in North American Indian communities, in Aboriginal communities, how much wisdom they have about maintaining a peaceful environment, about building relationships between peoples in communities. And then obviously revamp your national budgets for the prevention of conflict. Ask your representatives, what is your national budget for the prevention of conflict? Most people don't know. And ask what it is as a percentage of your budget for defense or rearmament, and just make the comparison. And then, the last part of the work that we're doing at the moment, and this may be of interest to your wonderful educational program, is we're designing education programs for young people who want to become active in peace building. And they're popping up like green shoots through concrete now all over the world. I train young social entrepreneurs who come again from every corner of the world. And what they need to know is not just the technicalities of preventing conflict, not just the political realities to be faced, but they need to know about the inner qualities that they need to build. Because my experience is, and I've made these mistakes myself, is that if I go charging into a conflict situation, thinking I'm right and the enemy is wrong and I know how to sort this out, it causes chaos. I have to be willing, first of all, to acknowledge and look at my own darker side. And that means quite a lot of work on myself. And I regard that as essential for young people and people entering the field when they're older, to really do the self-reflection, the self-awareness, the self-knowledge that is necessary to develop a person wise enough, calm enough, strong enough for when the chips are down. So thank you very much for your attention.
I now have the greatest honor to request Dr. Karan Singh, who is the representative of India to the executive board, the chair of the Mahatma Gandhi Institute, former cabinet minister, the youngest cabinet minister of India, a member of parliament, and so much more to address the audience. So you have
Thank you. Thank you. Today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Scilla M. Worthy, who has delivered a truly fascinating, thought-provoking, and very informative address, for which I congratulate her. Deputy Director General of UNESCO, Ambassador Ruchira Kamboj from India, Anant Duryappa, Director of the Mahatma Gandhi Institute for Education and Peace and Sustainable Development, and distinguished members of the audience, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. We live in a world of great tumult and turmoil and transition. When the old is collapsing and the new is struggling to be born, and there is a tremendous quest for new certitudes. All the old structures with which we grew up seem to be on the verge of collapse, whether they are economic or political or social. And what would an observer from outer space see in the world today? What would he, she, or it see? He would see that despite remarkable scientific breakthroughs, there's a rise of fanatic fundamentalist forces creating death and destruction around the world. There is widespread political violence. There's social violence. There's terrorist violence, which has become a major menace. There's individual violence and crime. The statistic, for example, that Dr. Elworthy gave, that more people are killed in the United States by toddlers than by adults, is really quite astounding. There's economic violence, poverty, continuing poverty involves violence, because when you have millions of people living on or below the poverty line, obviously it's a situation that will breed violence. And as the DDG has pointed out, in fact, a large number of negative factors are there. So the observer from outer space would probably conclude that the human race is on the verge of extinction, or nearly. There are two scenarios for the future of the human race. One is Arthur Koestler, you remember, the European philosopher. He claimed that the human race was a race programmed for self-destruction because of an engineering defect in the human cortex, whereby the thinking and the feeling elements are not adequately integrated. So we know what should be done, but we don't do it. As Dhritarashtra says in the Mahabharata, I know what is dharma, I know what is right, but I'm not attracted to it. I know what is adharma, what is wrong, but I'm attracted to it. What do you do? So Arthur Koestler says it's only a matter of time before the human race blows itself up. The alternative scenario is the one put forward by Sri Aurobindo, the great evolutionary philosopher, who claims that the human race is a race programmed for evolution. And he says that in the same way as life has evolved, human beings have evolved from the slime of the primeval ocean billions of years ago through material and vegetable and animal and human forms. There is no reason to believe that evolution has reached its peak. A human being is simply a transitional being, halfway between an animal and the divine. And therefore, the thrust of evolution itself is such that man or the human race will evolve into a higher race. Now, the jury is out, by the way, on which one of these two scenarios will finally prevail. But I think one thing is clear, that we have to work towards survival and evolution. We cannot accept the fact that after all the glories of human civilization, all the greatnesses, all the art, all the music, all the scriptural beauties, and all that human beings have achieved in the last 5 to 10,000 years will suddenly go up in flames, although that is becoming increasingly likely. And therefore, we have to build what I call a countervailing coalition against the drug traffickers, the arms traffickers, the fundamentalists, the people who live on violence and flourish on violence. And I think it is people like Professor Elworthy who really could lead that sort of a coalition which is so urgently required. Now, the Mahatma Gandhi Institute has been set up specifically for education in peace and sustainable development. And I'm glad to be able to report as chairman of the governing board that since its inception 3 years ago, we've already made some significant progress in this world. We are developing certain methodologies. Gaming, for example, gaming for peace is a very important aspect on which we are working. And just last month, we had in Delhi an international conference on preventing violent extremism through education. And that was the point that you came to Elworthy towards the end. When children grow up in an atmosphere of tension and hatred, how do you expect them when they become adults to become peace activists? If you look at the curricula of, I'm not going to mention any particular country, but if you look at the curricula of many countries around the world, you will see that they teach hatred. They teach hatred against another religion. They teach hatred against another country. So unless we change the curricula, unless we are able to get young people to be at least exposed to the sort of ideas that you expressed today, how do we possibly expect any substantial proportion of the human race to grow up dedicated to peace? So I think this is an extremely important area, the area of curriculum. And how do we get those curricula into the countries that do not accept the fact that peace is necessary? They do not accept the fact that all religions ultimately lead to the same goal. Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti, as the Rig Veda says, the truth is one, the wise call it by many names. There is another movement, Dr. Elworthy, which I hope that you will now start addressing, the interfaith movement. The interfaith movement began in 1893 in Chicago. And that was where you may recall Swami Vivekananda made such a tremendous impact. Now that interfaith movement, throughout the 20th century, we have had numerous meetings, world parliaments of religions and so on. That is an important movement, which has to be also involved in this whole coalition that I mentioned. Social movements like the Rotary and Lions and so on, all of these movements have got to work together to try and build up some kind of an atmosphere to prevent the extraordinary distortion of our psyche that you so effectively put before us. Now, Gandhiji's birthday, 2nd of October, has been accepted by the United Nations as World Day of Nonviolence. And this lecture, in fact, was supposed to have been on the 2nd. I'm sorry, I couldn't be here on the 2nd. We thought, let the people get together for the executive board meeting so that we'd have it now. And this begins a new series of Ahimsa lectures, which hopefully will be held every year here in UNESCO. We have a distinguished lecture series back in Delhi in the Institute, but here in UNESCO, which is really where the bulwarks of peace are supposed to be built, here it is important to reiterate the significance and eternal importance of these principles, which Mahatma Gandhi stood for his entire life. He lived for it, he died for it. And the power of his thoughts remain, and Nelson Mandela, as you mentioned, and Martin Luther King Jr. And people like that around the world will always be influenced and they will be energized and they'll be inspired by the thoughts of Mahatma Gandhi. Now, I do not want to comment upon a lot of what has been said. It's unexceptionable. It's very important, particularly the point that by humiliating the other, you're not going to achieve your goal. It's very important to have mutual respect. The media has a very important role to play. Let me give you the example. In India, we find that a lot of the media is very sincerely devoted to conflict, not to peace. If you listen to some of our anchors, and I'm not going to mention anybody, you'd think, you know, that Arthur Koestler is there himself and we're going to go up at any moment in a ball of nuclear disaster. So that is something which we have to factor in, media we have to factor in, the interfaith movement, and all the extraordinary things that you've told us. Frankly, I must admit, I've spent all my life in many of these areas, but a lot of what you've told us today is really news to me. Some of you are probably much better informed than I am, but the statistics you've given, for example. Now, whether a business plan for peace will work or not remains to be seen. However, I have to make one, it's not a discordant note, but it is just a remark. What happens when the forces of violence become so overwhelming? Would Nazism have been defeated, would Hitler have been defeated, had he not been defeated in war? Can ISIS be defeated until it is defeated in war? I know these are questions, they are uncomfortable questions, I know. They are unfashionable questions. But I'm afraid they're questions that have to be asked. Because if you look at the history of the human race, you will find again and again, forces have emerged which appear to overwhelm the world with their evil, with their hatred. How do you face them ultimately in the ultimate analysis? It's a question, it's not easy to answer. Of course, if we can build the peace that you mentioned, Dr. Elworthy, if we can have people like that, if we can change 5% of the tremendous budgets that we have towards peace, it would make all the difference. But we have to build up public opinion. We have to build up opinion among young people particularly. I'm old enough to remember when, you remember Bertrand Russell and the scientists got together and they started the Pugwash movement in the height of the Cold War. And that probably prevented a Third World War. The scientists should come up also. Science, we worship science nowadays and they're very remarkable people. But they have to come. Who are the people? And all the people who are making unlimited amounts of money through war and through this whole business. So it is a very, very complex issue. Having been in politics myself and into the interfaith movement, I am aware of the contradictions that are built into the very structure of human consciousness. What has happened is that the human psyche is fractured and fragmented, and therefore, in the ultimate analysis, and you came to that at the end of your lecture, I'm very glad, it is ultimately a spiritual process. It is a process within. If our psyches are fractured and fragmented and full of hatred and revenge and violence, we will never have a non-violent world. The violence we see around us in some ways is a reflection of the fractured and fragmented nature of the human psyche. And how do we move? We have to move inwards. We have to move towards the peace that resides within us, the peace that passeth all understanding. Until we move there, until we get to that place within ourselves, we will work outwardly also. But the real change will only come about. All I would say is, we'd better hurry up. Thank you.
Thank you to Dr. Karan Singh for that very, very insightful and thought-provoking address. I suppose, Anantha, we move on to a few questions, if there are any, before you have the last word. Would anyone like to raise a point or two or any questions? I see the ambassador of Iran. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, madam. We are late. I want really to thank you. This is one of the series of events that you, Indian delegation, organized. And that was the land of wisdom. And that is, and you see, the fact that India could manage to build a democracy, all of these hundreds of languages, religions, races, and that is a good example by itself. And your character. I have many questions, but the time is short, I cannot. My English is not very good, it's not my mother tongue. I wish I could speak English like you, but please help me to understand what I want to say. What I want to say is that here in UNESCO, when it was built in 1945, we were supposed to be an institution to be pioneer and inspiring for the politicians through these kind of intellectual declarations. We had our executive group to be intellectuals. Then gradually we shifted toward we totally intergovernment. Now, correctly, we are talking about this concept here, the real UNESCO concept. But when we come to decide to be a vehicle of these ideas here, we have to listen to political votes. And the political votes, most of the troubles around the world come from there. We are talking about ignorance, but ignorance is instrumentalized by politicians. And sometimes they feel very happy. Both sides. So if I am politically motivated, I cannot speak like this. But I'm not. And my question is that from Dr. Elworthy, so I was so deeply touched at what you say, and from the distinguished representative India that is a source of wisdom, how we can inspire this house to be more helpful toward this intellectual orientation than being toward politics.
I think the PhD should answer.
Well, thank you, Ambassador. I don't know whether this is going to get me fired, but I'm going to.
Me too.
I'm going to speak from my heart. I mean, this is an enormous challenge for UNESCO. It has evolved over the last 71 years. It needs to go back to the basics, to its core mandate. And that core mandate is intellectual cooperation amongst many stakeholders, not simply limited to governments alone. So we need to go back and do some soul searching and saying how do we can actually redirect, re-inspire UNESCO to its basic mandate, and that basic mandate is to build peace in the minds of men and women. And I don't think that we can actually do that in the kind of discussions we have in board meetings or information meetings, etc. We need more of this kind of debates, intellectual exchanges to make the world a better place.
Thank you so much for your question, Ambassador, and beautifully put. I don't know enough about UNESCO today. I had my first piece of work with UNESCO back in 1979, and actually that set me on my life's work because the commission I was given, and it was a commission to prepare a paper for the mid-decade UN Conference of Women in 1980. And the subject was the role of women in the prevention and resolution of conflict globally. So thank you, UNESCO. But what I wanted to mention in addition to what the Undersecretary said is that one of the ways in which I think UNESCO could assist in countries, particularly in countries prone to conflict, is the development of the competent women in that country, their education, and to make a list of all those who have adequate qualifications to be included in peace negotiations. Because at the moment, when I've investigated this, I've often been told, oh, there are no qualified women in that country, and it's not true. So my encouragement, one of the parts of this whole plan, is to ask people in countries susceptible to armed conflict for the women, supported by the men, to produce lists of suitably qualified women who can be included in not just peace negotiations, but the building of peace.
Thank you very much, Dr. Elworthy, and to the Ambassador of Iran. I can see two hands, so we'll take those two questions, those being the last questions, since we are running out of time, so please go ahead.
Go ahead.
You're loud enough. Just speak a little louder.
Okay. So the thing is, we talk a lot about the role of the private sector in the making of war, but I'm very interested about the role of maybe the private sector in the making of peace, because I'm from a generation which is very suspicious when it comes to the private sector. We grew up in democracies, in my case, I grew up in a democracy, but in Canada,
Thank you.
Should I take the second question also, maybe? Or would you prefer to? Yeah. Maybe we can take the second question, which is the last question. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. We, in the Balkans, are dealing with the people saying no start. And it's the same, I no start to you all. That means I do no start to you all. In our philosophy, instead of going to this modern education, we say that first, the peace starts from your family. And the doctor Elworthy also mentioned that if you are a family very peaceful, then you contribute that peace to your society, to your nation, to your community. If at this age of violence, and then studying so many philosophies about peace, citing various great thinkers and philosophers, and studying Sartre's international law. I come from a small country which has enjoyed centuries of peace in our Himalayan region, mountains, gorges, caves in our mountains. Our people seem to be very happy and peaceful. But with this opening of this global movement of the peace, we feel that whether peace is being defined in a different fashion, different manner, than that we have understood about the peace. Because in our philosophy, in our culture, in our day-to-day behavior, in our daily actions, we see a first cornerstone to have the peace in your own mind. Brother Ines puts out a very differently initiative to say, yes, peace begins the minds of the men and women. Same thing. Are we trying to construct the peace now in this 21st century? Then as a student of this international relations, I feel that the whole Charter of the United Nations is not building the peace, it is preventing the war, because the organization was established out of the war. So I think Dr. Elworthy, you mentioned about prevention of the war and building the peace. I do not believe that that would contribute in it. That means we are trying to construct the concept of the peace in our own way. But you also mentioned, and Dr. Constantine gave the example of philosophy in our own, say, Eastern civilization, we call it, that yes, if we follow, you mentioned about something inherent to in your culture of peace, somehow is respected, and it can start from an individual level to the international level. The point is respect each other, respect to others. Respect others, then the peace is start. Thank you very much. I do not have questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll deal with your comment because I entirely agree with you. And in all the material that we are assembling for this teaching and book and course on preventing war, a very important part of that is developing the inner power, the spiritual development. So in agreement with Dr. Karan Singh as well, I underline that in everything I do. In fact, I've written a book, a little book for teenagers called Peace Begins With Me. To come to your question, can you just remind me of the very substance of it? What is it that I know your question was about the suspicion of corporate involvement and the concern, and I do know this amongst millennials particularly, that governments are being now pressurized and bought by corporations and forced into directions that are contrary to those we've been talking about. Is that correct? So my colleagues' work now is going and talking with industries like insurance, who are dreadfully hit when there is a war because premises are raided, sea lanes are interfered with, and so forth. And so there's a very big potential for the insurance industry to get involved in peace building. I don't know exactly how that would happen yet, but we need to use our imagination for that. I've got friends now investigating in the banking and finance world how that industry can become involved. And one significant pointer is the investment in renewables. The investment in renewables is now going up like that. And we find that wherever there is a country or a region that has a significant population in favor of renewable energy, it's also a more peaceful environment. The other thing I would bring your attention to is the surveys that have been done by KPMG and Goldman Sachs on the values of millennials. They're very exciting. They show that 75% of those born between 1980 and 2000 prioritize people, planet, and purpose over profit. In other words, how people are treated in a corporation, how the environmental programs of the corporation actually work, not just on paper, and the sense of purpose and meaning that people have being employed there. And many young people that I know, when they go for interview, are now really asking very pointed questions about those issues and saying, even if you offered me a job at a very large salary, I wouldn't accept it because you don't measure up. And that's a very interesting change. And the last thing I would mention in this connection is the effect of online campaigning. Like, are you aware of Avaaz? There are now very large and fast-growing internet campaigns. Avaaz is growing at 1 million people a month, who are campaigning for peace. For example, they're doing a lot of campaigning for peace in the Syria conflict, but also on the question of the arms industry and so forth. So that's becoming more and more powerful, and it's something that is attracting, I would imagine, mostly people under 40. So my sense is, and I'd be interested to know if this is borne out by UNESCO's researches, my sense is that there is, I can't be specific about the numbers yet, but I hope to be, but a very large proportion of people under the age of 40 who are now interested in taking some action towards building peace because they are just so tired of the photographs of terrorists being on the front page. And that is something we should all ask our media to stop doing. Thank you.
Let me add a couple of points to my friend's question relating to the role of the private sector in either peacemaking or instigating instability, war, etc. We need to be extremely careful in the way we analyze situations, and there is nothing that says that the private sector is bad and the public sector is good. We need to be careful that the private sector is not particularly homogeneous. It does make significant contribution to our well-being in many areas. It is also government's responsibility to set the right regulatory environments so that even the arms industry doesn't go over beyond what the rules and regulations say and incite wars or hand over instruments, deadly instruments, to terrorist hands. Hence, the important thing is that we really, bottom line, we need to work on each and every individual in the globe to change their mind how important peace is and what peace means on a durable basis. And that really reminds me of what René Descartes once said, I think, therefore I am. So that is the level at which we should be working on to build sustainable peace.
Thank you very much. And may I request Anantha now to have the last word.
Right. It's an interesting position I've taken on to have the last word. You're never allowed to say have the last word, but so this is a great opportunity to have the last word. Well, let me do some thank yous, and then I wanted to have some very short reflections because I'm on negative time now because it was supposed to finish at 7:30. First, I really want to thank the ambassador for organizing this and her team. We couldn't have done this without them. And so, and I'm hoping that we'll repeat this next year as well, closer to the Mahatma's birthday. A thank you to the DDG for his time and to come to this lecture. We had the pleasure of hosting him at the Mahatma Gandhi Institute when he came to Delhi. So he's into games these days quite a bit. I'm surprised that he talks about that every place that he goes to, that he plays games with MGIP. We developed a number of games on sustainability and peace. but not least, I think we made a great choice for the first inaugural speaker, Dr. Elworthy. She gave us a real food for thought, very different from what you might have expected from a Gandhi Ahinsa lecture, but I thought she really opened up a lot of interesting things. And as a trained economist, when you were talking about an economic case, a business model, I've not seen this. I think it's a potential for a great paper. And I think the thing that was nice is that she made it very clear that peace is not an elusive goal. It can be achieved. And as you might know, the Institute gets its inspiration from Gandhi, from the Mahatma. But the challenge is, how do we solve ways to... is back. All right. So we get our inspiration from the neurosciences, and especially the seminal work of V.C. Ramachandran at UC San Diego, where he did his work on mirror neurons. But in a recent TED talk, he called it Gandhi neurons. And so what we do at the Institute is all of our projects are basically geared towards firing Gandhi neurons. Because if you don't use it, you lose it. And in a way, we have not been really using any of these. So it's the notion of neurons related with compassion and empathy. And it's not easy to do that. And that's where the challenge is. And so all of our projects, be it games, intercultural dialogue platforms, whatever that is, that's our fundamental goal. And so I was really happy when Dr. Elworthy talked about the inner self. The whole notion of self-authorship, as a neuroscientist is called, it's an extremely difficult exercise, which many of us really don't even spend much time thinking about. So with that, I want to sort of, on behalf of the Indian, the ambassador and the Indian delegation, invite you to samosas, maybe chai, for some refreshments. And thank you very much for taking your time to come out and being here so late, and it's a busy week as well for many of you. So thank you very much. As usual, I made a big boo-boo. My staff are kind of throwing things around. I would like to present a little...